sometimes when I see someone I know at the grocery store, I run the opposite way. Because that's practically public speaking, right? I mean, we're in public speaking. I have a tendency to say awkward things, so I'm glad I have words written out in advance. What if I'm still wearing my pajama bottoms? What if I wash my hair every day? These are all a possibility. But I agreed to do it because one of my 2016 intentions is to do more things that make my hand shake. I hate the handshaking part, but I'm starting to realize the part that comes after is the stuff that life is made of. Sometimes being a little uncomfortable is good for us. I have two precious boys, age 6 and 4. Raising two boys with autism means I frequently must make them do things they hate, things that make them uncomfortable, things that make them want to run away screaming. But I make them do it anyway because it makes them better and stronger and happier in the long run. If I make them do things because I know it's necessary to allow them to grow, then I must do the same to myself. Almost 7 years ago now, I gave birth to my first child, Grayson Michael Kelly, in the city of Los Angeles. I can't explain in words what it felt like the moment my eyes first saw his warm and wrinkled little body. I felt the mixture of love so big that the room couldn't contain it. I felt one part off. Holy cow, that wasn't just in and out of yogurt land in my stomach. There was an actual baby in there. And one part terror. Yes, terror. A love this ginormous, this monumental, this all-consuming carries with it the constant potential of pain. You see, everything in life has a cost. And the cost of love is pain, because we can't protect the ones we love from everything that the world may offer. Grayson looked up at me from his clear little bassinet. He looked like a tiny little swaddled doll, and it was our first evening together in the hospital. I made a wordless, love-filled pledge to my boy. I looked deep into his little navy blue eyes and said, I don't know what I'm doing. And I'm really scared, but I think we can figure this out together. We're going to be okay. I'm not gonna let anything bad happen to you. We're gonna be okay. I didn't fully believe myself, but I kept saying it over and over. You see, that mothering instinct that everyone promised would kick in after I held him the first time, it wasn't there. My instinct was broken, and there wasn't a place I could go in town to get it fixed. The second night in the hospital, Grayson didn't cry. He screamed, like a pterodactyl. Is that him? I asked my husband. In response to the shrill sound filling our hospital room, what are we supposed to do about that? I had never babysat anything that had done that. We took turns, one holding and rocking and the other one googling. I looked up happiest baby on the block where I cursed myself for not watching the video I'd received at my shower. I tried all the recommended 5S, like swaddling, sucking, shushing, lying them on his side, swinging, none of it worked. As time went on, I slowly figured out what I was doing. I began to know the high-pitched cry meant his stomach hurt, and it usually happened from 8 to 10 every night. The really loud cry meant